There are moments in history which represent a fundamental turning point. The economic crash of 2008 represents precisely such a turning point. And you have to understand that that was not a normal crisis. It represents a fundamental break in the situation. Now, Marx explained that the capitalist system moves through booms and slumps. There will always be this cycle of booms and slumps until the capitalist system no longer exists. That has been the case for the last 200 years, and it will continue to be the case. You get ups and downs. That's the normal economic cycle. But if you examine the history of capitalism over the last 200 years, particularly the last century, in addition to booms and slumps, you see something else. There are clearly defined periods which are different in character, different in nature. The period before 1914 was a period of long upswing of the productive forces. Which was also accompanied by an enormous strengthening of reformist tendencies. Which was tragically revealed in the summer of 1914. That opened up an entirely different period. Which lasted up until 1939, to the New World War. The 20s and 30s was a period of convulsions which had never been seen in history. But that again was cut across processes which we've explained, and after the Second World War, the capitalist system recovered from that, and there was a new period of growth, of upswing. Which lasted until approximately 1973, 74. The 1970s was again a period of economic crisis and massive class struggle. Revolutionary situations in Greece, in Spain, in Italy. Massive class struggles in France, of course, which began in 1968. And in Britain. And a period of crisis of the mass organizations, mass left wings, and so on. But that period ended because of the treacherous policies of the labor leaders, the socialist and so-called communist leaders. Who could have taken power and refused to take power. Which allowed the capitalist system to recover. That led to a period of relative economic equilibrium, so to say. Which again bred certain illusions in the bourgeoisie. And the economists and the politicians. And also the so-called left leaders. The illusions in reformism were enormously increased. They thought that this boom was going to last forever. Yes, they always think that. They always have the same illusion, these gentlemen. And ladies, mustn't forget the ladies. And then we had this tremendous crash. The crash of 2008 was the biggest economic crisis in 200 years. That crash completely destroyed the economic equilibrium which they thought had been established. And 7 years later, 7 years of unemployment, of poverty, which was supposed to not exist anymore. Of vicious attacks on living standards. Of terrible suffering for millions of people. As in Greece, which I will deal with later on. 7 years of cuts and austerity. And I ask you the following question. Has the bourgeoisie succeeded after 7 years in restoring the economic equilibrium? The answer is clear to a blind man. Emphatically, no. They've not succeeded in restoring anything remotely resembling economic equilibrium. If you don't believe me, read what they say themselves. A few months ago, the OECD, that's the organization of representing the advanced capitalist countries, put forward a perspective for the next 50 years. You see, the bourgeoisie also have perspectives, not just the Marxists. And the more intelligent bourgeois tend to come to the same conclusions as the Marxists with a slight delay. By the way, how can they work out a perspective for the next 50 years? For the world economy? You can't even predict the weather for more than 3 days. And they usually get that wrong also. But anyway, what are the perspectives for the next 50 years for the world economy? The perspective of the OECD is no growth for the next 50 years. That's the perspective. Now, if you accept that, and I do, the new catchphrase now is what? Secular stagnation, isn't it? Secular stagnation, that's what they say. They openly talk about this. What does it mean? What is that perspective? It's a perspective of cuts, attacks, and falling living standards for the next two generations. That's the perspective. And that means it's a finished recipe for an explosion of the class struggle everywhere. That's what it means. Ted Grant used to say that we will enter into the most turbulent period in human history. I will correct that perspective. We mustn't talk in the future tense. We have already entered into the most turbulent period in human history. That's the period that we are now living in. And you see certain things flow from that. Lenin said that politics is concentrated economics. Let me quote one of the representatives of the bourgeoisie. He's not the cleverest one, actually. In fact, he's exceedingly stupid. Mr. Donald Tusk, or Tusk, I suppose it's pronounced. Have you heard of him? He's a Polish right-wing politician who is now, I believe, the president of the European Union. Perhaps that's why the European Union is in crisis, I don't know. And this gentleman, I say he's stupid, because a bourgeois politician should never say what you think. You don't do this, it's not done, it's not done. But Tusk, Mr. Tusk, who by the way played a leading role in this Greek deal, so-called deal, one of the main vicious hardliners who wanted to destroy Greece and destroy the government of Greece. Says the following, you know, as we say in English, he let the cat out of the bag. He revealed the secret thinking of these people. He says the following, and I quote, "I am really afraid of this ideological or political contagion." Not financial contagion, he said. Not financial, political contagion. Of this Greek crisis. That's an interesting observation. And he goes on. "It was always the same game before the biggest tragedies in our European history. This tactical alliance between radicals from all sides today, for sure, we can observe the same political phenomenon." And he continues, "For me, the atmosphere is a little similar to the time after 1968 in Europe." 68, as you probably know, was a period, the year of the biggest, most revolutionary general strike in history in France. That's what he's referring to. He goes on, "I can feel," he feels a lot because he doesn't think very much, feel it, anyway. "I feel maybe not a revolutionary mood, maybe not a revolutionary mood, but something like widespread impatience And here's the most interesting point. You can even notice a glimmer of intelligence in this man's dim brain. When impatience becomes not an individual but a social experience of feeling, this is the introduction for revolutions. Now, what Tusk said, which he shouldn't have said, is what the others are thinking. The strategists of capital understand what we understand. And they're absolutely terrified of the future. The reason why they're terrified is that they've never been in a situation like this before, ever. Never. There's never been an economic crisis like this. With a huge mountain of debts, which is weighing them down, weighing the economy down like a heavy stone. And they've never faced a working class as powerful as this. As a result of the development of the productive forces for the last 50 years. The strength of the working class is 1,000 times greater than what it was in the past. And the social reserves of reaction are weaker than what they've ever been in the past. We're in Italy. 50 years ago, there was a very big peasantry in Italy. 50 years ago, there was a huge peasantry in Greece and in France and even in Germany. Where's the peasantry now? It's a very small section of society. And that was one of the main reserves of fascism and of Bonapartism in the past. And now the Italian bourgeois is forced to carry out cuts in the tax. All the capitalists of the entire world are compelled to carry out cuts, deep cuts, far deeper than what you've seen so far. In Britain, just 1 week ago, the British Chancellor of the Exchequer was talking about a 40% cut in social spending. 40%. And from a capitalist point of view, that's absolutely necessary. Absolutely necessary. Because of these huge debts. They must do this. The problem they face is that the working class is bigger and stronger than what it's ever been in history. And when they try to carry out these cuts, it will lead to one explosion after another. We expressed this a few years ago as a kind of equation, if you like. We said after the crisis of 2008, I make no apology for repeating, all the attempts of the bourgeois to restore the economic equilibrium will destroy the social and political equilibrium. Yes. And that is precisely what has happened. in one country after another. The social and political equilibrium has been destroyed, or is being destroyed, producing enormous political instability. That is what Tusk is, and the others are afraid, are terrified of. And yet, despite of all the efforts, they've not succeeded in their intention of restoring economic equilibrium. They were talking about a recovery. Where's the recovery? You'd have to take a powerful microscope and examine the figures to see a genuine recovery anywhere. In America, there was a slight recovery. There's been a slight recovery. But the masses do not feel that there's a recovery anywhere. They don't believe it. They don't feel it. Where's the recovery? And now, the bourgeois economists are talking about a new recession in the near future. This so-called recovery is so fragile that any shock can cause a slump. That's why they were terrified of the position in Greece, which came very close to being driven out of the Eurozone. And in my view, that is still inevitable anyway. They only postponed it, that's all. That would have meant a catastrophe, an economic catastrophe for Greece, of course. But what frightened them was the effects in the Eurozone. It could have detonated a series of crises in Spain, which is only one step behind Greece. And in Italy, which is only one step behind Spain, you could see the collapse of the euro in one country after another, and the collapse of the common currency itself. And that would undoubtedly provoke a massive international recession. There's no question about it, no doubt about it. That's why Obama was constantly on the phone to Angela Merkel. You've got to solve the Greek question. You've got to solve it. You've got to do something. You've got to make concessions. You've got to give them some money. Because he could see the effects of the United States. But he wondered the problem with that piece of very good advice. Obama wouldn't have to put his hand in his pocket to pay the money. The Germans would have to pay. The German rulers would have to pay. You know, over many years, I have realized that one of the most pleasant experiences in life is spending other people's money. Very enjoyable experience. Yes, but the Germans were not amused. And they said, danke, aber nein danke. No, thank you, but no thanks. You know. But we'll come to Greece a little bit later. Or China, never mind, everyone's looking at Greece, a few people are looking at China, you should look at China. Chinese economy is in a very precarious position, I think. Yes. Rob just showed me today's headlines in the Financial Times. This is the front page headline. Shanghai's 8.5 fall, a blow for Beijing. You understand what I said? The Shanghai Stock Exchange has just fallen by 8.5%. I've lost the page. I don't understand these things. Yeah. And the subheading is second biggest fall in markets history as support effort fails. Now that should put the fear of God into the bourgeois. The Chinese bourgeois, the leaders of the so-called Chinese Communist Party, some communist party, a bourgeois party, which has been pursuing capitalist policy for I don't know for decades now. And by opening up the Chinese economy, it undoubtedly helped the Chinese capitalism. It helped a lot. And it helped the West, helped the Americans, the Germans, and so on. New markets, new fields of investment, huge profits, at the expense of the terrible exploitation of the Chinese working class. We're working under conditions like those that Marx described in the first volume of Capital. Or Charles Dickens described in his novels about Victorian England. And on the basis of squeezing the Chinese working class, they got huge profits. They were very happy, huge profits from it. Both for the Chinese capitalists and, of course, for the American and German and European capitalists. And that led to a big development of the productive forces in China. It's undeniable. Can't deny it. And everyone was happy. China was producing a vast amount, and it still is producing a vast amount of cheap goods. Not just ladies' underwear and tennis rackets and toys. But high-tech goods. There isn't a single mobile phone in this hall. I hope they're switched off, by the way. Or a single laptop that isn't full of equipment made in China. But of course, there's a problem here. And by the way, for those communists who are worried about the development of the productive forces in China, I say, please don't worry, communists. Don't lose any sleep over this. We should be delighted at the development of industry in China. Absolutely delighted. Because it's created the biggest and most powerful working class in the world. And that has got revolutionary implications. And furthermore, this process now has reached its limits. You see, the Chinese market, although it's grown quite a lot, it's true, it's too narrow to contain this mass of goods which they're producing. China must export or die. And they've been exporting massively to Europe, to the United States in particular. The problem is, it's not difficult, it's not rocket science. If Europe and America are not consuming as they consumed in the past, China cannot produce. Where are they going to export? To the moon, perhaps? Or maybe to the planet Pluto, they're investing in. Perhaps there's a market there, I don't know. There's nowhere else they can export to. And therefore, the Chinese economy, for some time, it's not a new thing, has been faced with overproduction. There have been factory closures. Debts are not paid. There's a huge amount of unpaid debts. That's reflected in a sharp slowing down of the Chinese economy. And the Chinese officials themselves, the Chinese government itself, in the past said that any growth less than 8% per annum would be a disaster for China. It's now 7% officially. And I believe it's less than that. You can't trust the Chinese figures. You can't. Don't trust them. And that's been reflected in big falls on the stock exchange in China. For months, in recent months, a couple of months. This latest figure is only the most recent, but it's the most significant figure. In the last few months, the Chinese stock markets have lost 30% of their value. 30%. That's trillions of dollars. Millions and millions of poor Chinese people, small business people, small shopkeepers, have had their savings wiped out. At the stock exchange, it doesn't represent the real economy, that's true. But it's a barometer which roughly tells us where the economy is heading. And hanging over the whole thing in China, hanging over all this business, there's a massive, what do they call it? A housing bubble. Massive. The same as what existed, the same that existed in America, Spain, Ireland, Iceland before the collapse of 2008. The same. The Chinese government is alarmed. They're right to be alarmed. And they spent huge amounts of money to prop up the stock exchange. Huge amounts of money. Don't know how much they spent. Vast amounts. It's true that China's got huge reserves. That's true. They built up huge reserves. But all the reserves in the world will not save them once the thing begins to collapse. Stop it. As that headline in the Financial Times indicated. I just read it. I read it. The rescue attempt of the Chinese has failed. They failed. They spent vast amounts of money and they failed. And a serious crisis in China, that would spell a big slump in the world economy. Be sure of it. You see, they had the delusion that the Buddhists, they've become delusional. You know? They really have. They thought that Asia was going to save them. Twenty years ago, I remember I had an argument with he's now an ex-comrade in Spain. Ratti, used to be a personal friend of mine. But he went a bit crazy after the fall of the Soviet Union. And he was arguing, oh, look, capitalism can exist for almost indefinitely because there's Asia, there's new markets, there's China. Look at Asia, Asia, Asia. I had to tell him the facts of life, and that was 20 years ago. He fell for the bourgeois propaganda. What's the position now in Asia? What's the position of the so-called BRICS? The emerging economies, as they used to call them. Now they're more like the submerging economies. The slowdown in China, even before a serious crisis, has had a devastating effect in countries like Brazil, Argentina, Australia, Korea. All the BRICS are in crisis. The Russian economy is in crisis. They're all in crisis. And therefore the world economy will not be saved by those people. On the contrary, dialectics teaches us that sooner or later things change into their opposite. The Chinese economy and Asia was, it's true, for a period, one of the main motor forces of the world economy. Now the same thing that pushed the world economy up is going to drag it down. And that will have a huge effect inside China. You see, sometimes people ask me, well, if things are so bad for the Chinese working class, why don't they rebel? Why isn't there a revolution in China? Good question. Good question. You see, it's an interesting phenomenon. These workers in China are peasants. They come from the villages. Where the conditions are really bad, really appalling conditions. And therefore, however bad they might be in a factory in Shanghai or Guangdong, they're better off than what they were in the village. They work hard, long hours, but they send a little bit of money back to their families. And of course, there's always the hope that things will get better. There's the hope. In fact, wages were rising somewhat in China in the recent period. They had to increase wages, which is another reason why there's a crisis. But what happens when there's a slump, a deep slump? Mass unemployment. These people are driven back to a life of poverty in the villages. What happens then? Now you see, You don't know what's happening in China. Neither do I. It's a totalitarian regime, and their information is tightly controlled. So it's difficult to know exactly what's occurring. But the limited information that has come out of China shows that there's been an increase in strikes. Peasant uprisings, riots over land and other things. And I noted a couple of years ago, I think it was 2 years ago, that for the first time in history, China spends more on internal security than it does on external defense, and it spends a lot of money on external defense. Chinese ruling class has got a very good idea of what's happening in the factories because they've got spies everywhere. And there's the little question of inequality in socialist China, run by a communist party. Can you imagine? China is one of the most unequal countries on earth. And yet it's supposed to be socialist. They still got the cheek to call themselves socialists and communists. There's extreme poverty on the one hand, and extreme exploitation. And at the other extreme, there's the most obscene luxury. You couldn't imagine it. Obscene luxury, ostentatious luxury. China's imported a lot of luxury cars, Rolls Royces, and what they got, Bugattis, did they call them? Let's go. Yeah, okay. Importing all these, what's this, Italian luxury car? Pepe's got Ferrari, no, there's another one. Bugatti's there, I don't know what they call it. Yeah, Bugatti, I knew I was right. Pepe's got imported into socialist China. I'll just give you one example. Well, the son of one of the richest tycoons in China, recently, it must be crazy, he put on Facebook, he put on the web, a photograph of a dog. It's a husky dog, actually, what the Eskimos use, you know, husky. So he's got a dog as a pet. So the commenters there say, well, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with the man can have a dog if he wants it. Yes, but if you look closely at this photograph, on both paws, the dog's got a watch. As the cop said, he must be a watchdog. But not just any watch, not just any watch. These are what do they call them? Apple Watches. I don't know what an Apple Watch is. You know, an Apple Watch. Apple Watch. Obviously, the dog needs to tell the time. You know? Not only tell the time, it has to surf the net. Obviously, this must be a clever dog. Each of these watches cost $10,000. That gives you an idea of the ostentatious luxury of these gangsters, who of course are linked to the Chinese so-called Communist Party and the leadership of the Communist Party. And therefore, you can be sure that the Chinese, among the Chinese workers, there must be a seething indignation, a seething indignation. Which must be expressed in an explosion, which I will predict, will occur when nobody expects it, when you least expect it. Precisely because it is a totalitarian regime. There's to be no warning of this. And to paraphrase the words of Napoleon, the Chinese proletariat is a sleeping dragon. When this dragon awakes, the world will tremble. Now, I think I've said, I don't want to say any more on the economic question. But it's clear that we're facing another deep downturn. You see that in the crisis of the Eurozone. The so-called agreement with Greece has solved absolutely nothing. Years ago, we predicted that the euro could exist as long as there was an economic upswing, it could continue to exist. Because when there's plenty of markets and so on, the gangsters can reach an agreement, like the gangsters in Chicago. You know. They can reach an amicable agreement. But we said, let there be a severe downturn, and all the national contradictions would resurface. And the euro at a certain stage, we predicted this. I remember the precise phrase that we used. Will break up amidst mutual recriminations, blaming each other, you know. That was shown by the Greek crisis. The European bourgeois split right down the middle. A section, particularly France and Italy, but also Spain, was arguing that they should make concessions to Greece, give them some money. Make concessions. And by the way, they could have reached a deal. The difference was very small. Because Tsipras made every conceivable concession. He surrendered, actually, as a typical reformist. So they could have reached a compromise, as they've done in the past. That's why the French and the Italians, Renzi was desperate to get a deal. Because Italy is in a very serious economic crisis. This so-called progressive Renzi has carried out a series of cuts. But now I think he's afraid to proceed, and he would like to reflate the economy. He would like to get the Italian economy moving. He wants to decrease taxes, some taxes. But the Italian debt is 130% of the gross domestic product, as far as I remember. It's nearly 2 trillion, isn't it, Pepe? The Italian debt is nearly 2 trillion, isn't it? Yes. The Italian debt is nearly 2 trillion euros. So there's a clash now between Italy and Brussels, actually. The European Union doesn't want currency. They want them to continue to cut. That's why Renzi wanted them to make concessions to the Greeks. That's the reason for it. They could have eased it. So why didn't they? Why didn't they reach a deal? The German bourgeoisie, not only the Germans, but particularly the German bourgeoisie, was determined to sabotage the deal, determined from the beginning. They demand that the Tsipras continues and deepens the policy of austerity of cuts. A policy which, by the way, has clearly failed. It's clearly failed. Even from a capitalist point of view, it's failed. In 5 years of brutal, vicious, savage attacks against living standards. Which has reduced the people of Greece to a state of abject poverty, of beggary, literally. I think comrades in this room, they don't understand the degree of desperation that exists in Greece. Schools without books. Hospitals without drugs. You've had doctors, during the referendum, doctors were coming onto the television saying, we must say no because in my hospital we don't have any drugs. And yet, after 5 years of all these attacks, which was supposed to solve the deficit, supposed to solve the debt, rather, what has happened in Greece? At the beginning of the crisis, I think the debt was 120% of the GDP. Which means Italy is more than it was at that time. It was 120. 5 years of vicious cuts, it's now 180%, more than 180%. Of course, you destroy employment, you destroy people's living standards, people can't consume, can't pay taxes. How are you going to pay this debt? And a bourgeois economist, an optimistic gentleman, obviously recently said, about last week, he said, don't worry, it's okay. He said, the Greek debt will reach 200% of the GDP. And then it will go down. This is madness. It's madness. It's the economics of the madhouse. And let's be clear about this. Greece can never pay this debt, not in 1,000 years. They cannot pay. And yet, the German bourgeois showed themselves to be absolutely ruthless, pitiless. Merkel is supposed to be the pleasant face of German capitalism. Supposed to be. But look at the face of this monster Schäuble. the finance minister, as I like to call him, the poison dwarf. It's the face of cruel, pitiless, merciless ruling class. With the mentality of the most primitive kind of usurer. You know a usurer? The debt collector that comes to somebody's house. Who owes money to the debt collector. Pay me. Got no money. Sell your television, sell your carpet, sell your furniture. You still can't pay. I'll take your house, go on, live on the streets. And by the way, that has occurred not just in Greece. That has occurred. It's occurred in Spain massively. I don't know how many families in Spain, hundreds of thousands of people have been kicked out of their, by the banks, kicked out of their houses, thrown on the streets. Now Lenin pointed out, it's on the agenda of the school, question of imperialism and war, that in the he described the present period as the period of monopoly capitalism as the highest stage of capitalist development. And he pointed out that one of the key elements of this period is the domination of finance capital. The crushing domination of the big banks. The dictatorship of the big banks, who decide everything. Elected governments decide nothing. And what this the Greek situation has clearly revealed is precisely that fact. Ever since 2008, it's been absolutely clear everywhere. The bankers rule. National sovereignty is an empty phrase, means nothing. And so-called democratic government means nothing. You can elect whatever government you like. The bank, a small clique of bankers will decide what happens. In Greece, it's blatant, it was clear. On January the 25th, the people of Greece voted massively for a series of government. Pledged to the end of austerity. And there's a very important point which you have to realize. You know, sometimes comrades are a bit impatient with the working class. It doesn't seem to be moving. Why aren't the workers moving? And it's true. You see, nobody likes to struggle with it. People don't like change, as a matter of fact. They don't like it. Normally. People like a quiet life. And yes, workers will accept and accept and accept. And bow their heads and accept. Because they're afraid of losing their jobs, they're afraid of being sacked, they're afraid the factory will be closed. The capitalists will move to China, although we find it a bit difficult now to move to China. Yes, they will accept and accept. But you know, there are limits to all things. There are limits to all things. And there's a limit to how much the working class can tolerate. In Greece, that limit has been passed a long time ago. I've lost count of how many general strikes took place in Greece. I don't know how many. 30, more than 30, I can't remember. Mass demonstrations and so on. Yes, but even that is not sufficient in this position. It's not sufficient. Even the most powerful general strike in and of itself doesn't solve anything. It doesn't solve anything. It poses the question of power. But you need a party and a leadership that's prepared to take power. So the workers voted massively for the Syriza government. And by the way, here's another lesson. In this turbulent period of class struggle, you will get violent swings to the left and to the right. Because the masses are desperately looking for a way out, they're looking for a solution. But there is no solution on a capitalist basis. They will test one political party after another. One leader after another. One program after another. And then they will reject it. Just look at Greece. 2 or 3 years ago, 2 years ago, I think, Syriza was struggling to get 4% of the votes. The PASOK seemed to be the main party of the Greek working class. Millions of supporters, a trade union base, powerful trade union base, and so on. But the PASOK entered a government that was carrying out cuts. The working class got a good lesson in what the PASOK, the reformists, stood for. They did a good lesson. And now the PASOK has been crushed. It's been wiped out, almost wiped out. Whether it can come back, I don't know. It's an open question. Maybe not. And Syriza, from a small sect actually, just like a sect, almost like a sect, massively won the election. But of course, the Tsipras and the leaders of the Syriza, they're reformists, left reformists. And Trotsky pointed out, we must remember this, betrayal is inherent in reformism. All reformism. I would say particularly left reformism. Now, it isn't that they consciously set out to betray, they don't. I actually met Tsipras when he came to London. Last year. Seemed a nice young man. Seemed to be honest enough. You know, doesn't beat his wife. Doesn't kick the cat. Helps old ladies to cross the road. You know. Well, full of good intentions. Yes. And I'm sure that Tsipras wanted to help the Greek people, I'm sure. But the problem is this. If you accept the capitalist system, you must accept the laws of the capitalist system. And it doesn't matter. You come into power. Either the government of Syriza was going to take serious measures against capitalism in Greece, expropriate the parasites, the bankers and the capitalists, which they could have done easily on more than one occasion, easily. But they didn't do it. Why? You know, I've come to the conclusion, and I'm firmly convinced of this. All the reformists, all of them, even the most left of them, Jeremy Corbyn in Britain and so on, though we support him, but you must understand, all these ladies and gentlemen are profoundly convinced to the bottom of their soul that the working class cannot run society. They don't trust the working class. They have a contempt for the working class. They treat them like little children that they have to give a few sweets, give a few concessions to that sort. And all these reformists are profoundly convinced that only the bourgeoisie has the right to run society. I've got no doubt about this. They believe this. They believe it. And Tsipras believes it. That's why he acted as he did. And these people, they think they're clever, but they're very stupid people. He thought, well, I'll negotiate with the Germans. He said, with Varoufakis, we will be nice to them and we'll be talk to them. Maybe make a few concessions. We will smile, big smile. And they will smile back to us. And we will make a few concessions. And they will make some concessions. And everyone will be happy. Big mistake. Big mistake. These negotiations are not negotiations at all. The Germans had no intention of negotiating with Tsipras. On the contrary, the intention from the very beginning was to crush Tsipras, to crush Syriza. If possible, either force him to carry out to do the dirty work and carry out deep cuts and betray the people, that's not a bad idea, is it? Because you get someone to carry out the cuts on your behalf, and it has the advantage that you destroy the image of socialism in the eyes of the masses. You see, you wanted socialism, that's socialism, you see. Preparing the way for a swing to the right. And by the way, that's the role of reformers, that's the role, historically. To demoralize and disappoint the working class and prepare a swing to the right. So, and Tsipras and Varoufakis, they were like little children, like a lamb going to the slaughterhouse. They got nothing. From the beginning, it was clear they were going to get nothing. We predicted that. And finally, Tsipras called a referendum. Which, is, by the way, was the correct, it was the right thing to do. I said, actually, in February, when it was clear that he wasn't going to get any concessions, I said, if I were Tsipras, I would call a referendum. Get the support of the Greek people to take action. So that was something he did that was correct. But you saw what happened. And by the way, the result of that referendum was astounding. What is 60-odd%? 60, almost 62% voted no to these monstrous conditions. Not just the working class, but big sections of the middle class. The peasant, even the islands, voted massively no. And that was in spite of an atrocious press campaign. Again, it shows the reality of the so-called free press. All the media, all the press was pressing for a yes vote and trying to make people afraid of the results, the catastrophe if you vote no. The European Union deliberately forced the banks to close during the campaign, deliberately. To create an atmosphere of fear. And despite all these things, the Greek people massively voted no, an act of defiance. Not only that, but there were huge demonstrations. The mood in these demonstrations was electric, completely electric. And I have not the slightest doubt, one word from Tsipras, if you would have appeared and said, now, the only way to deal with this, my friends, is we must take power into our own hands, take over the banks, expropriate all these parasites that don't pay tax, the big ship owners and all these people who sent billions outside of Greece, wrecking the Greek economy. You could have had a peaceful revolution in Greece. Nobody would have resisted it. By the way, the Golden Dawn also supported the no. There's no alternative. Listen, another little observation here. You know, it isn't only the reformers that have a contempt for the working class. The big majority of the so-called left and so-called Marxists also have a contempt for the working class. Don't believe them in the working class. You just think, all this time, all these idiots, What was the perspectives for Greece? Well, fascism, of course. What else? Oh, the Golden Dawn, fascism. Better hide under the bed. I love every time I was interviewed on several occasions by Greek newspapers, including the official paper of a citizen. A nice young lady interviewed me, she's quite friendly. But they're all the same. What about the new? Don't you think there's a risk of fascism? This was just before Tsipras was elected. I said, no, look, be serious. Don't be silly. The pendulum in Greece is swinging far to the left, not to the right. And our perspective is certainly be correct. It isn't to say that you can't have a turn to the right in the future. That's a different matter. That's inevitable at a certain stage. But at this stage, Cyprus could have taken power easily. What was the problem? Being a reformist, he didn't see the referendum as a means of mobilizing the masses, and they did mobilize the masses, but as a means of putting pressure on the Germans and the negotiate. You call millions of people on the streets to negotiate. He must have thought, now we'll show them our power. Now they'll make concessions. Did they make concessions? They imposed far worse terms, harsher terms than what they previously turned down. And what did Cyprus do? Naturally, he signed a complete capitulation, a complete betrayal. Naturally, I repeat, betrayal is inherent in reformism. And Greece is a clear indication of that. You see, why did they take this position? Why did Merkel and Schäuble and the others take this position? Why didn't they do a deal? Well, it's partly about what I said for the economic greed and brutality. But there was another reason, more important reason, which our Polish friend explained. It was Tusk explained. They were afraid that if Tsipras got away with anything, it would have a big effect in other countries. And by the way, it's not only Greece where people are up to here with austerity. It's not only in Greece. It's everywhere. And they didn't want, for example, Podemos in Spain, they would be enthused by this. The left all over Europe would be enthused by it, encouraged by it. To step up the fight against austerity. And therefore they had to crush the Syriza government. It was an attempted coup, yes. It was an attempted coup. Regime change. They were open about it. Quite open about it. We must replace this government, a democratically elected government, must be replaced, because we say so. And replaced by another government, maybe a national unity government. It's a complete negation of the democratic rights of the Greek people. It shows you just how much bourgeois democracy is worth. It's not worth anything. And of course that had a very demoralizing effect in Greece. You can understand, many people now are in a complete despair. You can't trust anybody. There's a kind of fatalistic mood. What can we do? Yes, but on the other hand, there's a very angry mood. Very angry mood. Particularly among the activists, the youth, and inside Syriza, there's a mood of fury. Today, the leader of the so-called left of Syriza, Lafazanis, is calling a massive rally. Was it yesterday? Or 2,000 people were present. I didn't know. I thought it was today. Oh, yeah. What's it? It's Tuesday, isn't it? Yesterday, yes. Well, perhaps Elias can give us a report of that meeting. But the support for the left is increasing. In reality, Tsipras now only controls the parliamentary group. That's all. The youth of Syriza has come out against the deal. The branch of Piraeus, the proletarian heart of Athens, has come out against the deal. I think most, if not all, the Syriza branch have come out against the deal. The Central Committee has come out against the deal. So what's the problem? The problem here is the left, the cowardice of the left, the left of the left, if you like. Let's be clear about it. There is no future for Greece on a capitalist basis, whether inside or outside of the European Union. Lafazanis and Syriza is entirely false. If Greece leaves the Eurozone, and I think it's inevitable that at a certain stage they'll be pushed out anyway. What will happen? The drachma, if they call it that, we'll call it what they like, will immediately, it'll fall like a stone. It'll be worthless. And because Greece has got to import almost everything, there will be massive inflation, and even hyperinflation like Germany in 1923. The Greek economy will collapse. Unless they take socialist measures, that's the only solution. Which none of these gentlemen is seriously putting forward. The expropriation of the bankers and capitalists. If the bosses threaten to close the factories, occupy the factories. So they're not putting it, none of them is putting this forward. And of course, the future of Greece will be a very turbulent future. There'll be massive swings to the left and to the right. And a sharp polarization to the left and to the right. Some comrades thought, wrongly, that the Greek Communist Party, the KUKUE, was finished. I heard even experienced comrades say that. Because the KUKUE had a very sectarian, ultra-left position, actually. Instead of proposing a united front with Syriza, which is what they should have done, they've had a hostile, they've opposed Syriza all the time. They refused to participate in joint demonstrations, they call separate demonstrations. And even in the referendum, they didn't support the no vote. They said, in effect, abstain. Spoil your papers. Which is a crazy position. It's an ultra-left position. Which failed, but it failed, incidentally. Because 80% of the voters of the KUKUE voted no in the referendum. Quite right. And therefore some comrades said, due to the conclusion that KUKUE was finished. I said, you're wrong. It's not finished. On the contrary, the KUKUE will grow now. And in spite of their ultra-leftism and their sectarianism, and paradoxically, because of their sectarianism and ultra-leftism. Now, there's such fury at the betrayal of Tsipras that people will say, yeah, the Kukui was right, the communists were right. This man is a traitor. And I believe the Kukui is growing and it will grow. On the left. And that's why your comrades correctly have oriented towards the Kukui. That's the correct position. And the golden dawn will grow on the right, be sure of it. They'll grow. I think they'll probably change the name. They probably fuse with other groups because it smells too much of fascism. Greek people don't like fascism. I won't say anything more on Greece, except that there'd be big possibilities for our comrades if they were correct, which they are doing. I make no apologies for concentrating on Greece, because Greece shows you the future of every country in Europe. Every country. That's the future. And therefore you have to study it closely. You have a similar situation developing in Spain. And you saw an enormous swing to the left in Spain. Just a couple of months ago. In the local and regional elections. And you see, look, be clear on this, comrades. Comrades, everything has changed. As I said, in Greece, the PASOK has collapsed. And Syriza now, that also will collapse. In Spain, 2 years ago, Podemos did not exist. Now it's the main force on the left in Spain. And the Socialist Party has been, I won't say that it's been completely liquidated, but it's very close to it. And our comrades in Spain have correctly turned towards Podemos, which has mobilized hundreds of thousands of people, including the most radical elements of the youth of the working class. The left, in these local and regional elections, the left won decisive victories in all the big cities in Spain, all of them, including Madrid, Barcelona, Valencia, Zaragoza. They won in Galicia, which is, if you know Spain, it seems unthinkable. Galicia was always a backward area where the Popular Party, the right wing, had a strong base. They were defeated. In Zamora, backward agricultural area. I think it's the only place in Spain where the United Left, that's the former Communist Party and a few others, they won in Zamora. I was in Galicia on holiday at the time of the elections, just after the elections. And we visited a tiny village where Anna's family lived, 40 years ago, under Franco. Tiny, in a backward agricultural area. I think only 60 people lived there. There was only one electoral poster, and that was the Socialist Party, which is very left-wing for that place. And outside the bar, we were astonished, outside the bar, there was a Republican flag. Astonishing. There's a big movement, especially among the youth, against the monarchy in favor of republicanism and so on, which is a good thing. My friend Pepe Blanes, I don't think he's here this year. We were together with Anna and Mila in the underground for a long time. Pepe said, you can't imagine the situation in Spain. He said, there's only one historical parallel that occurs to me. And that's April 1931. But yeah, 31. Yeah. That's when there was a big victory of the left in the sources of Republicans in the municipal elections. Which led to the collapse of the monarchy at the beginning of the Spanish Revolution. Now, I don't know, maybe Pepe is a little bit, maybe it's not quite at that level. But it's certainly moving in that direction, certainly. Take Barcelona. Barcelona was always controlled, the council in Barcelona, always controlled by the Nationalist Party, the CIU, the FIU, Bourgeois Nationalist Party. They were, for the first time, they were beaten by the left, a very left candidate. A woman called Ada Colau, who's famous because she led the struggle against people being against evictions. And she stood on a platform against evictions, against the banks, against corruption. And the first thing she did when she was elected, there was a huge rally, by the way, which really was to get elected. The first thing she did was to vote or pass a rule, cutting her wage by three quarters. Cut her wage, her own wage was cut by three quarters to 2,200, I think, euros. I think. Just compare that to our British democracy. Where these gangsters just voted themselves a wage increase of 10%. First thing they did. And how much did they earn anyway? £74,000 they earned, no? That's more than 80,000 euros, I think. At the same time, they're preparing a law almost to outlaw strikes, to make strikes almost impossible. They think, they hope, it won't in practice. And a wage limit in the public sector, no more than 1% pay increase for the next 4 years. I could say more about these elections in Spain, but I won't, lack of time. Just one point. In Navarra, which has been controlled for a long time by the UPN, which is an extreme right-wing Navarrese nationalist outfit. The elections were won by Bildu, that's the radical Basque left-wing party. I mean, that seems incredible to me. You could hardly believe it. So, frankly, comrades, we're in a period here of sharp and sudden changes in the situation. And you must expect the unexpected. You saw, by the way, the common feature of all these cities, all countries, is that beneath the surface, and perhaps not so far beneath the surface, among the masses, especially among the youth, but not only among the youth, there is a tremendous mood of anger, of rage, of discontent, above all, I would say, of frustration, which is not being reflected by the existing mass organizations of the past. It is not. And that's the problem. That, you saw that, by the way, in Ireland, where there was a referendum recently, about a month ago, on the question of same-sex marriages. It's an important issue, obviously, particularly for people who are affected by this. But it was very surprising that in this referendum, there was a massive vote saying yes to same-sex marriages. And by the way, in Ireland, there's no postal vote. You can't vote by post in a referendum. People were coming from Australia, United States, New Zealand, to vote in this referendum, which was a massive vote against the Roman Catholic Church. Against, that's what it was. Massive. In Ireland. This is incredible. Ireland was the most Catholic country in the world, probably, with the possible exception of Poland. Not long ago, the priest would go in the villages, he would go from house to house and ask people, why is there no baby in this house this year? In case they were using contraceptives. But because of the scandals of the paedophile issue, which is disgusting in Ireland, they found hundreds of corpses of little children buried in convents. All this is covered up by the church. I mean, this, my friends, is a political earthquake in Irish society. It shows a fundamental change in the mood of people. And there's a general feeling against the establishment in all countries, against all the establishment. Not just the bankers and the rich people, against the press, the police, the judiciary, and the political parties. All of them, are seen as part of the establishment. In Spain, Pablo Iglesias, the leader of Podemos, put it very well. He put forth the phrase of la casta, the caste. It is disgusting, the conduct of these people. Disgusting. And you saw that reflected in Scotland, in the Scottish referendum. Again, a political earthquake. The Labour Party in Scotland had an absolutely, apparently, an impregnable position. Huge support. The establishment in Britain got a shock during the referendum, where the whole mood of society, especially the working class in areas like Glasgow, was for a yes vote. In the general election, the Labour Party in Scotland was liquidated. How many MPs did they have? They left with one MP. And the SNP, which stood demagogically on the left program, swept the boat. Swept the boat. There's been a big growth of the SNP, including workers, left-wing people, socialists, and so on. I think they have 15,000 trade unionists in their trade union faction, which is more than the Labour Party in Scotland has members. Now, frankly, the blindest of the blind should be able to understand that this is a fundamental change. The blindest of the blind should be able to see that. It was in. I was puzzling how this could be expressed in south of the border, in Britain. It wasn't clear. Labour was defeated, soundly defeated in the general election. The Tories were returned. Of course, the Labour leader stood in a hopeless problem. And they got their just deserts. They were justly rewarded. But what? At the conclusion, by the way, the conclusion of the Labour leaders is we must go further to the right. You know. But the pure accident played a role. The left in the Labour Party up until now has been as dead as a doodle. Dead as a door, silent. And yet, Jeremy Corbyn, who's a left, one of the very few lefts that are left, put his name forward. Now, he could not get the requisite number of votes in the parliamentary party. He couldn't get them. He got 17 votes. I think he needed 35. To get on the ballot paper, we need the 35 votes. All the lefts, soft lefts, semi-lefts, so they could only get they could only get 17 votes, 17 signatures. So they went around pleading with right-wing MPs. Please, will you please give us your signature, poor Jeremy? And very foolishly, Blairites signed the name. Very foolishly. Thinking that he would get nowhere, get no support. Corbyn got massive support. Particularly outside the Labour Party. Outside the Labour Party. Massive support. When he appeared on television, he's the only one that put a clear case against austerity. Now, there's a comical aspect to this. For years, the Blairite, the right wing, wanted to dissolve the Labour Party into the mass of Labour voters. That's what they wanted. Because the activists were supposed to be to the left of the Labour voters, the mass of Labour voters. You see, none of these people have understood the change that's taking place. They had the brilliant idea of giving anyone that paid £3, anyone, could vote in the election, election for leader. Thousands, tens of thousands of people have voted. The overwhelming majority vote for Corbyn. And it is possible he might win, I don't know. Because the booze bar is frightened of this, the Blairites are furious. And they'd pull out all the dirty tricks possible to stop him from winning. But nevertheless, it shows that once there's a focal point, through which this accumulated discontent can express itself, it will do so. Now, I've got only a little time left to deal with an important point. But incidentally, just one PS to that. Before we leave the advanced capitalist countries, also in America, you see important developments. For example, on this question of racism, this horrible massacre that took place, this terrible massacre in a church. Yes, but you see, this is South Carolina, this is the heartland of the Confederacy, the slave-owning states and so on. The home of the Ku Klux Klan. In the 1950s and 60s, the Ku Klux Klan regularly threw bombs at churches and killed people, regularly. Nothing happened. This time there's been a colossal reaction. Demonstrations, protests, not just of blacks, but whites as well. Most were whites as well. And they voted to remove the Confederate flag from the city hall, which is a big thing. Plus, then you have this development of the American community of Bernie Sanders, who calls himself a socialist, although he's a member of the Democrat Party. No time to deal with that. Now, my time is almost finished, and I haven't dealt with a fraction of the globe. But I must, the time that's left to me, must deal with the question of the Middle East, which is in flames from one end to the other. As a result of the crimes of imperialism, especially American imperialism. The Iraq war completely destabilized the whole region. And that now poses dangers even from the standpoint of imperialism. Incidentally, before the invasion of Iraq, there was no Al-Qaeda inside Iraq. None, zero. Saddam Hussein would have dealt with them not very gently. And now just look at the wreckage that they've left in Iraq. And in Syria. And in Libya, and it's extending throughout the whole area. This monstrous reactionary movement of ISIS, it is of course. And very late in the day, the Americans have decided they must do something about it. Because it's a threat to their interests. And here you see the limits of American power. The weakness of American imperialism, as a matter of fact. You know, George W. Bush said, after the invasion of Iraq, "Mission accomplished." The American powers will excuse my poor imitation. Yes, what's been accomplished? What mission? What's been accomplished? They say, well, they'll drop bombs on ISIS. Yes, but that has almost no effect. This kind of warfare does very little effect. In order to succeed against ISIS, they need troops on the ground. They keep on talking about boots on the ground. The question is, whose boots? Whose boots are they? Not American boots. The American public is fed up, this war weariness. They don't want any more involvement in foreign adventures. Least of all in Iraq and the Middle East. So who's going to do the fighting? The Kurds, to some extent. Yes, but the Kurds will only fight in their own areas. So that's not enough. So the only other possibility is Iran. Wonder of wonders. The axis of terror was mainly Iran, plus North Korea, I don't know who else. 2 years ago, the Americans were preparing to bomb Iran, together with the Israelis, to stop Iran from getting nuclear weapons. And now, amazingly, they're all pals, all friends. The Economist on its front page a week ago. The Economist on its front page. It carried a big word, I don't know if you can translate this. Ayatollah. Friends. Yeah. Don't you believe it, by the way, don't you believe it? You know, a very clever man once said, nations do not have friends, only interests. Yes, but it's in the interest of American imperialists now that Iran should increase its war against ISIS. That is why they signed the deal of nuclear weapons. That's why they signed it. Yes. Which, by the way, is a big victory for Iran. Big victory. The people in Tehran were dancing in the street. There was a big demonstration. They weren't dancing in the street in Israel and in Saudi Arabia, however. The Israelis and Saudis are furious. And Netanyahu said that this is a threat to world peace. I don't know what he didn't say. And of course, he's in contact with the American Republicans, the Republican right wing, most of whom, as we know, are clinically insane. Yes, but what he said actually was correct. He said this deal will not stop Iran from getting nuclear weapons. Of course it will not. But what stinking hypocrisy. Israel has got nuclear weapons, it's had for a long time. And by the way, there's no question whatever of allowing any international observers inside Israel to look at their installation. No question at all. Unlike Iran, Israel has not signed the nuclear non-proliferation treaty. Nobody mentions that. But there's no question about it. This deal will enormously increase the, Iran's power as a regional power. No question about it. The ending of sanctions will have a big effect on the Iranian economy, which has been in a bad state for a long time. And they'll give them a little present. $100 billion will immediately go into Iranian hands. Which was frozen by the sanctions. To cover his bare ass, to cover his backside, Obama says, ah yes, but don't worry, we can always put sanctions on again in the future if necessary. Yeah. And military sanctions will remain. There'll be no question of selling arms to Iran. You know, I believe that with $100 billion, Iran can buy a few little weapons elsewhere. From Russia, from China, or from anywhere else. So Netanyahu's worries are well grounded. But what will the effects of this be inside Iran? That's interesting. One of the weaknesses, you know, there's been big protests in Iran, big uprisings in Iran against the regime. But the weakness of this movement, these movements, is that it was mainly confined to the middle class, the intellectuals, the students and so on. There wasn't a massive participation by the workers. And the economy has been depressed. Now there's going to be an economic boom in Iran because of the removal of sanctions. And that will have profound effects on the class struggle inside Iran. By the way, there's something that I'm going to say now might surprise you. Despite its image as a Muslim country and so on, Iran today is the most modern, the most secular, and the most progressive country in the Middle East. Paradox. You wouldn't believe that, but it's true. Of course, the mullahs still try to maintain control. But the control is slipping all the time. Now, the wages of the workers have been held down for a long time. Many workers, hundreds of thousands of workers, have not been paid for months, perhaps for years. Therefore, an economic boom, the recovery of industry, and I'll predict this now, must lead to a big upswing of strikes and the economic struggle. And under Iranian conditions, economic demands will very quickly become political demands. And therefore, we're talking about a big revolutionary potential inside Iran. This time with the participation of the working class, which is a very powerful working class. What form will the Iranian revolution take? Can't really answer that question. First of all, there will be democratic demands, that's clear. Revolutionary democratic demands. And by the way, in that context, we would support the demand for a constituent assembly. That would be correct. Democratic demands. But that can very quickly, the working class can put its own demands forward. And one thing you can be absolutely certain of, one variant is completely ruled out. After the experience of the last 30 odd years of a dictatorship of the mullahs, it is absolutely impossible that the Iranian revolution would take the form of any form of Islamic State. That's out, that's finished. They've been through that experience. And therefore we must try to get a base inside Iran before the movement comes up. Now, if you look at the whole of the Middle East at the present time, it appears as black reaction from one end to the other. It's a counter-revolutionary situation. The enormous potential of, for example, the Egyptian revolution, the enormous potential, where the workers could have taken power easily, has been wasted. You know. But something was missing. When Morsi was overthrown, 2 years ago, wasn't it? When Morsi was overthrown, 17 million people came out to the streets in Egypt. The Bolsheviks never had that kind of movement in 1917. And power was in the hands of the Egyptian people, if you like. But something was missing. Something was missing in Egypt, which was not missing in Russia in 1917. A revolutionary party with a revolutionary leadership. And let's be clear about this. If it hadn't been for the presence of the Bolshevik Party, I will go further. If it hadn't been for the presence of Lenin and Trotsky, two men, Russia would have gone the same way as Egypt has gone. Don't forget that the Russian Revolution passed through a reactionary phase in July and August. Power in Egypt, power was lying in the streets. Power was lying in the streets, waiting for someone to pick it up. And because of there was no revolutionary party to take power, The generals took over. And now we have a reactionary situation in Egypt. But the Egyptian revolution is not finished. Any more than the Russian revolution was finished in August 1917. And any more than the Spanish revolution was finished after the defeat of the Asturian Commune in 1934. But there are two key countries, leaving Egypt out of the picture, which can provide a fresh impetus to the revolution in the Middle East. One is Iran, as I've stated, and the other is Turkey, where again there's a powerful working class, where there have been big insurrectionary movements against this monstrous regime of Erdogan, really is a monster. And he was moving in the direction of Bonapartism. When the recent elections dealt him a terrible blow. He was defeated in the elections. The AK party lost its majority. And there was the rise of this left-wing Kurdish party, the HDP, which is related to the PKK, that's the military wing. How does Erdogan react? This bastard, words fail me. This swine is supposed to be a member of NATO. Supposed to be fighting against ISIS in Iraq and Syria. In reality, he's been supporting ISIS actively. When Kobani was on the was a Kurdish town on the border, was being attacked and slaughtered by these monsters, by the ISIS. This bastard was allowing ISIS fighters from other countries to go in past the Turkish frontier, to go in to attack the Kurds. And stopping Kurds from going in to fight for their brothers on the other side of the border. The Kurds in that area are left wing, the PKK is left wing. It's doubly dangerous from Erdogan's point of view. And he's determined to crush, not ISIS, he's determined to crush the Kurds. They're supposed to be in negotiations. So what does he do? Last week, a few days ago, a suicide bomber, allegedly from ISIS, went into a small town on the Turkish side of the frontier, entered a building that was full, not of Kurds, but of young left-wing Turks. That wanted to help the Kurds on the Iraqi side. You detonated a bomb and there was a massacre. I don't know, about 30, 35 people were killed, something, 32 I think. Which provoked an enormous wave of revulsion in Turkey. And that was undoubtedly organized by the Turkish state. There's no question about it, no doubt about it. Everybody knows this. The PKK has reacted, unfortunately, in the Turkish area. There's been these indications of returning to the armed struggle, as they call it. They killed a few policemen, which is a very stupid thing to do. So they should have arms to defend themselves. But that just plays into the hands of the regime, actually. We must explain, we've got contacts with Kurds and Turks, we must explain to them. The only way to defeat this monster is not through isolated acts of terrorism, but by creating a mass united movement of Turkish and Kurdish workers with the aim of a general strike and an insurrection, armed insurrection, against this monstrous reactionary government. And therefore, it's the Turkish workers, the Kurdish and Turkish workers of Turkey, and the workers of Iran that hold the key to the Middle East at this moment in time. Now, I have to finish for lack of time. But I think I've said sufficient for you to realize the correctness of our perspectives. Which we've held for many years. But I will just finish with one thought. You see, revolution is implicit in the situation. But as we've seen in Egypt and even in Greece, revolution can only succeed if we have built the necessary revolutionary forces to provide the necessary leadership. And that, comrades, must be done before the revolution. After it starts, it's very difficult. You know. And therefore, that's our task. The task of this school is to educate and raise the level of the youth in the first instance, and to organize and to build the only force on the planet that can show the way out of this nightmare of capitalist barbarism. That is to say, to build the forces of a mass Marxist international.